In this video, we look at a problem that involves maximum power. So as you can see, we're asked to find the Norton equivalent circuit along with the maximum power. Okay, and this is our complex circuit, and here's our nodes of interest, A and B. And as you can see, the load has already been removed. So I started this problem by finding the Norton resistance by using the test source method. And specifically, as you can see here, I used a test voltage source. So here's my test voltage source of 1 volt connected between A, B. Okay, and as we've discussed, when you're using the test voltage source, R Norton or R Thevenin, because remember it's the same resistance, is just equal to that test source value of 1 volt divided by the current for that test source of 1 volt. Okay, so the objective here is find the current for this test source, then we can do the ratio, and that's our answer for Norton resistance. So to do this problem, I just set up node voltage. I made this bottom node ground, right? Because if I make this bottom node ground, okay, also notice, you know, we got rid of the independent current source. That's this open. That's the ideal internal resistance of an independent current source. But again, as we know, seen many, many times by this point, can't eliminate dependent sources, right? So the dependent source stays. Now, this node here, right, this is known. There's 1 volt at this node with respect to ground because that's where our test source is connected. So we only have this node over here that we gotta that starts off unknown. But look, Vx, the voltage that this dependent voltage source depends on, that's the voltage across this 2 ohm resistor. And that test source is connected in parallel with that 2 ohm resistor. So in this problem, right, Vx, the variable our dependent voltage source depends on, is just equal to the test source value. So that means that 2Vx here is just 2 volts. The value of that dependent voltage source is just 2 volts. So if I have 1 volt with respect to ground on this side of the dependent voltage source, and it has value 2 volts, well, the difference between the voltages at these two nodes that the dependent voltage source is connected to is that 2 volts. Now, on this side is 1 volt, so the question is, well, is the voltage on the other side of this dependent voltage source going to be 2 more than 1 or 2 less than 1? Well, as we've talked about before, that's where the polarity comes in. See, the polarity tells me that this is the higher end of that 2 volts that's across the dependent voltage source. So if I label this node C, okay, VC is just going to be 2 plus 1. Okay, so you see VC is 3 volts. So in this particular problem, we didn't really have to write a node voltage expression. It's just the way it worked out that it was, you know, easier to do just by you know, going back to our understanding of what voltage across and voltage at nodes and what polarity means. So it's just going back to some fundamentals. So now that we have the voltages at all the nodes, right, this is ground, 1 volt here with respect to ground, 3 volts here with respect to ground, and I know the resistor values, I can get what the currents are. See, the current through the 6 ohm resistor, it's going to flow down from 3 volts down to ground. And the voltage across, or excuse me, the current through this 2 ohm is going to flow down. It's going from 1 volt to ground. Okay, so the current for the 6 ohm would just equal 3 volts divided by 6 ohms. Okay, so that's half an amp. And the current for the 2 ohm, well, that's going to be 1 volt divided by 2 ohms, so also half an amp. OK, Okay, so we got half an amp flowing down here, half an amp flowing down here. Now, this dependent voltage source is in series with that 6 ohm. So see, there's also a half an amp flowing through this dependent voltage source. So now if you look at node A where the test source is connected, we now know there's half an amp flowing out of node A here, half an amp of current flowing out of node A here. So the current for the test source has to be flowing into node A, right? Because if you got two currents flowing out, you got to have at least one flowing in. This is the only other current that we have in this problem at node A. So this test source current is just going to be the sum of the two currents through the resistors. So our Rn, our Norton resistance, is just going to be the 1 volt divided by 1 amp. So 1 ohm, that's our Norton resistance in this problem. Okay? All right, but we need to get the Norton current, right? Because remember, a Norton equivalent circuit is a current source in parallel with the resistance, right? The Norton current source in parallel with the Norton resistance. Now, I decided in this particular problem to solve for V open circuit and then just get I short circuit, which is the Norton current, just by Ohm's law. So going back to the original problem here, and I made the bottom node ground again. Okay, and we're going to have two unknown nodes. We have an unknown node here that I labeled C. Okay, and then also this is an unknown node A, right? Once we find the voltage at node A with respect to ground, that is our VOC, right? Because remember, VOC, that's the voltage across AB with an open across, or nothing connected between A and B, and that by definition is our Thevenin voltage, right? And once we have that, we can just do Ohm's law to get what I short circuit is, and that's our Norton current. So here I define currents, well, first of all, notice what we have. Haven't seen this in a while, but remember, this dependent voltage source, it's not connected to ground on either end, so that's a supernode. So remember, when you have a supernode, for purposes of the KCL equation, you just treat it as a single node. So I defined a current like this, I1. That's an arrow going up here. And then I defined a current for the 2 ohm resistor. Now, the 2 ohm resistor has Vx defined across it, so I defined the current to agree with that polarity that was given for Vx. So I call that current I2. Okay, so the KCL at the supernode is just going to be 10 plus I1 equal to I2. Okay, so then we're going to have 10, and I1 in terms of voltage is going to be 0 minus VC over 6. And then I2 is just going to be VA over 2, right, because VA minus 0 over 2. And then we have, well, now we have our one node voltage expression but two unknowns, so now we look at the voltage source to get another equation. So this tells us that VC minus VA is equal to 2VX. Okay, 2VX. So because of the dependent source, we end up with another variable. So now we need a third equation, and this is where we look at the circuit, and if you look here, VX, which is the voltage across the 2 ohm, well, that is VA, right? Because the 2 ohm is connected to node A on one side and ground on the other. So you see VX is just equal to VA in this circuit, so we can write this 2VA Alright, so now we have two equations, two unknowns. We can go ahead and solve for the unknowns. Now, as I said at the beginning, VA is what we're after. That's going to give us the open circuit voltage here. So I just solved for VA, and if you solve for VA correctly, it comes out to 10 volts. Okay, which again, that is the Thevenin voltage. Okay, so now to come up with the short circuit current, which is the Norton current, it's just the Thevenin voltage divided by the Norton resistance. Because again, remember, Norton resistance and Thevenin resistance, same value, same resistor. So IN here is just going to be 10 volts divided by 1 ohm, so that's 10 amps. Okay, so our Norton equivalent it's going to look just like this. Right, we're going to have a current source and resistor in parallel, and this is 10 amps, and this is 1 ohm. Okay, so that's our Norton equivalent, and now we want to find max power. Okay, well, as we discussed in the previous video, max power occurs when you have a match, which means when the load resistance equals the Thevenin resistance. Right, we proved that last lecture. We had the derivation. So to find max power, since the Norton resistance is 1 ohm, and again, you know, Norton resistance and Thevenin resistance are the same. So wherever you see Thevenin resistance, you can put in Norton resistance. All right. So you also have a match when the load resistance equals the Norton resistance, which is 1 ohm in this case. So now to find what the max power is, the number of watts that we have when we have a match, we just connect a 1 ohm resistor as our load resistor. See, this is our load resistor equal to 1 ohm. And see, all I got to do is solve for the power through this load. And since the load resistance and the Norton resistance are the same, well, this current is going to split up evenly. Right? When it gets to this node here, half is going to go through this 1 ohm, and the other half is going to go through that 1 ohm. So to get the power, the max power, PRL, it's just going to be 5 amps squared, okay, I'm using I squared R, times the RL value. All right, so 25 watts. Okay, so that's our answer. You know, as added practice, you should write out the Thevenin equivalent circuit for this problem, and also verify that you get the same answer for the maximum power of 25 watts. Okay, well, that's the last lecture of EE 112, and I wish you good luck on the final for this class, and also good luck for any future circuit classes that you take.